Welcome to Safari Live's Sunset Safari today. As you can see, we're at the Juma Waterhole with some buffalo bulls. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have a VM on camera. We have Jamie and Dangerous Dave out on the other vehicle. And we have Rebecca and Louise in final control. So, nice little group of old boys. And if we zoom in on their head, you can see with this backlight why he's flicking his ears so much. Look at those flies. Isn't that just incredible? Most of those will be what are called stable flies. They look very similar to the common house fly, except they're vicious little bloodsuckers. So they'll be biting on his ears, on the thin skin there, because for most of the buffalo is going to be too thick for them to bite. So they buzz around and bite on the ears, drawing blood and feeding off that blood. Now, they do attack us occasionally as well, and they can be quite annoying. And after the bite takes place, which is initially a little bit painful, but also quite irritating and itchy afterwards. But let's move away before the flies realize that we're here. We've spotted some other creatures around. Oh, and here come right behind us. A nice little harem of zebra heading towards the waterhole. So now, very interesting if we watch zebra. Now, the zebra that's leading from the front is generally the oldest and most experienced female. The stallion normally takes up the back. And often when zebras get very agitated and angry and biting each other, it's because the wrong female is leading the herd. The stallion always tries to keep the oldest, most experienced female at the front of the herd. But a big welcome to North Landing Elementary School and Miss Coffin's class. Welcome to your live safari. As you can see, we've got some of Africa's wonderful animals right here. And this is the Birchall's or Plains zebra that are heading towards the waterhole for a drink. And there we go. But moving away from the zebra, and Mrs. Coffin noticed some birds on the back of the buffalo. And she's wondering, do those birds help rid the buffalo of flies? They don't, unfortunately, help rid the buffalo of flies. They do help rid the buffalo of ticks and other ectoparasites. And while we keep seeing what's happening here on around the waterhole, let's go to Jamie, who's got Africa's biggest animal.
Good afternoon and welcome to our safari. And we've got such a special treat for you. A whole herd of elephants has just walked right across the road in front of us. Now, I didn't want to move earlier because I was going to disturb them, but there's even little babies running at the back, all protected by the rest of the herd. And they're feeling hot and they want to go and find themselves a drink. And unfortunately, we can't follow them where they're going. So we're only going to have a little bit of time to spend with them. But you're so, so lucky to be seeing the world's biggest land mammal. I know it's hard for you to get a sense of scale, but they are absolutely enormous. Hello, my name is Jamie. And this afternoon I'll be driving along with Brent, and we're going to find animals to show you and show you around and tell you a little bit about them. Behind me sits a man called Dave. Now, Dave is very, very camera shy, so he likes to hide behind the camera, but he's the person who's showing you all of these incredible things. And I'm sure you've got lots of questions about elephants. Elephants happen to be one of my favorite animals to see out here. Got one last straggler. You might be able to get a view of him. An elephant herd is a very special family unit. It really is a family. And Annalise, you're reading my mind and thinking just about what I was going to tell you. This is a young male walking behind the group. Now, Annalise wanted to know if a male or a female elephant leads a herd. And the answer is it is the females. It is what's called a matriarchal society. A female will stay in a herd her whole life, which can be up to 60 years in the wild, so close to being as long as a human. And some of them have stopped there to feed, so we've got another chance to view them. So the females lead the herd. It's led by the oldest female in the group, the oldest and the wisest. She will have a collection of her daughters and her granddaughters and her sisters and her cousins and her nieces, all as part of a group. Here you go, you can see they're all clustered just over there. Lots and lots of them disappearing off into the bush. With a couple of young males straggling behind. Now, the life of a young male is a little bit different. So they stay with the herd for between sort of 13 to 15 years, at which point it's time for them to leave home because they are no longer welcome within their family herd. And they head out on a solitary life, either walking about on their own, or they're going towards the, or they're going to join up with other young males, just so that they've got a bit of company. Because as you can imagine, for them growing up in such a big family, being all alone can be quite a scary thing. Henry, you wanted to know where an elephant gets its water from. And the answer is here. There's quite a lot of water around. There's a lot of water holes. You were with Brent at one of them earlier. But elephants are very clever and they've got a very good sense of smell. And they can actually smell water underneath the surface of the ground because they've got those big, strong trunks and tusks, those teeth on the end of their faces. And they've got big, strong toenails. They can actually dig out water. So they dig and they dig and they dig. And they wait until the water seeps up from underneath the surface of the soil. And elephants are actually quite fussy drinkers. Oh, there's a little baby. And the tails and ears swishing. Rocco, yes, flies do irritate elephants, just like they do the buffalo. Luckily, they've got those trunks on the end of their faces as well as the swinging tails to sweep them away from them. There you go, the little baby is having a quick drink from mom before she moves off. Now, speaking of buffalo, let's find out if Brent's buffalo are still being bugged by the flies.
Here we go, there's the buffalo in the background and a herd of zebra moving away from the waterhole. And as we sweep through here, you can see we're having a very dry time. That's normally got water in it. This is normally a big water hole. But there are some impala having a little argument. It's two young boys. It's more playful than serious. But maybe next year they'll be competing for ladies. So it'll be a bit more serious then. So Ember, very observant of you. Yes, we are having a drought at the moment. But we do have a very dry season. Even when we don't have a drought, this year is just extra dry. Oh, we can hear some more elephants screaming in the distance. So Dustin, looking at those zebra at the back there, is wondering why do they go in packs? Well, Dustin, they don't go in packs as such. Packs is a word we refer to members of the dog family, dogs and wild dogs are in packs. Zebras are in harems, and the reason they... Sorry, Dustin, I'll get back to your question. I'm just listening. There were lions not too far from here this morning, and I think those elephants are chasing those lions. So we're going to drive, and I'm going to answer your question there, Dustin. So there's a couple of reasons. So the male zebra keeps a few females pass on his genetic code. And also, the more of you there are, the less chance you're the one that's going to be eaten by the lion. So speaking of lions, we saw five this morning, not far from here. And they went into the thick bush up there, but I think the elephants have found those lions and are busy chasing them. So that's what sounds is. Elephants can make lots of different noises. And what I can hear is elephants screaming. And they only do that when they're upset. So Abby is wondering, why were those impala fighting like that? Well, Abby, if you know boys, why do little boys push each other and want to wrestle all the time? They were just playing. But when they get older, that fighting will become more important so they can get some females of their own. Like this. So there, Abby, there's a big impala over there. And he's running there. And he will chase all the other males away from all the ladies here. So these are his ladies. But here we go. So he's done well for himself. He's got lots of girlfriends. Now, Rocco's wondering, what do impala eat? Well, Rocco, impala are very successful because they eat grass and leaves. So most all male kudu running across the road in front of us. There we go. That's a big male kudu disappearing quite quickly. Rocco, impala eats grass and leaves. An animal like a kudu only eats leaves, and an animal like a zebra or a buffalo only eats grass. And that's one of the reasons we see so many impala, is because they are able to feed off both instead of just one. So those elephants were screaming just down here, and that's where the lions went across out of our area. And elephants will chase if they see them. So the true king of the African bush is not a man, it's a male elephant. He's the biggest animal out here, and the elephants are also the strongest, but they don't like lions. Hi, Michaela. Michaela would like to know, is there more than one type of elephant? There are, Michaela. There is the Asian elephant and the African elephant. The Asian elephant lives in India, Malaysia, and through the East. The African elephant lives in Africa. Now, even amongst the African elephants, we have two sort of, not a subspecies, a different sort of type. So you can imagine, how to explain this properly. So some people are tall, some people are short. So you have an elephant like that, and that's because of where the elephants live. So we have the African savanna elephant, which is the one you've just seen with Jamie, and the one we're going to go see what they're chasing. Then you have the African forest elephant, or it's also sometimes called the African pygmy elephant. Now, don't be fooled by the name pygmy elephant. It's still very big. Probably around 12,000 to 15,000 pounds, a big male, but it's much shorter than the savannah elephant.
Again, what happens is that we go through a bit of a tricky signal area. As you can imagine, doing something in real life in the bush and then being able to show you all across on the other side of the world, every now and again things go a little bit wrong and the signal disappears. So that's why Brent vanished from your screens and why you're back on our vehicle. But you've timed it very well because I have almost arrived at where I was planning on going. Fortunately, to get to where I was wanting to go, it is a main road, which means that every now and again we do encounter various trucks going backwards and forwards to the different lodges. And believe it or not, this for us in a game reserve is a main road, this dirt road in front of us. All right, everybody, get ready to wave to the man in the truck. Here we go. He looks like he's been delivering diesel for the cars to run on, gas for the cars to run on. That's very sad. Oh, he did wave to me. He did wave back. I was about to be very sad. That's okay. He waved to us all. Hello, Rocco. You were wondering about whether or not, going back to our elephant sighting, whether or not an elephant will eat from its nose. And that's a really good question because an elephant kind of does use its nose to eat. So let's go for an example. But they don't eat through it. You know how uncomfortable it is when you accidentally choke and you get food up your nose? Uh-oh. We can't do an example yet because I'm blocking up somebody's road. Let's just move off for them. Here we go. They've got plenty of space to come past me and I can answer Rocco's question. So that elephant trunk is absolutely amazing. So I'm gonna not quite pretend to be an elephant, but you'll have to, hi guys, you'll have to kind of stretch your imagination. I'm gonna jump out of the car and I'm gonna show you what I mean. Because what they do is they actually take the food in their trunk, they twist it, then they break it over the tusk, the teeth that stick out of their face, and then they pop it in their mouths. So if, and only if, I were an elephant, let me try and find a slightly more appropriate tree first. I don't want to eat that tree, it's gross. Trust me, I know. It's very gross. And Dave will agree with me. Dave will never eat that tree again, having had a little bit of experience. I made Dave eat it without warning him what would happen, and it takes away all of the spit in your mouth. So we won't be doing that to Dave again today. Now let's stop at this nice weeping wattle tree and I'm gonna hop out and I'm gonna show you what I mean. So, an elephant's trunk, and Dave will tell me if Brent has anything happening on his side, so you don't need to worry about me wandering about outside of the vehicle. An elephant's trunk is capable of moving kind of like we can move our arms. It's got muscles that run all the way down it and across and diagonally. And there's 50,000 to 100,000 muscles in its trunk. And then at the tip, it's got these really, really sensitive lips at the end. And they're so, so coordinated that a big elephant can reach down and pick up a stick that is this small. So just like we could do with our hands, an elephant could do with their trunk. Just realized there's thorns on that. Yes, I know, they're there. I found them with my skin. But what an elephant does generally, they've got several different methods. And this big trunk, usually, what they're gonna do is they're gonna reach around. Very often they'll wrap it right around the tree like this, but I'm not gonna do that because I'm not an elephant and my skin's not very tough and it actually hurts. But what they'll do is they'll reach with the trunk and they'll strip away the leaves like this. So basically pulling them off away from the branches. And then they'll take it and they'll put it into their mouths. If they wanted a bigger branch, like this size, and this is an easy branch for an elephant to eat, even a baby elephant could get this down, they'd pull and then they'd pull it across. Using their trunk, they'd pull it across their tusks and break it like that. Now that's the way that elephants eat the food that they do eat. Now this tree, just while we're here, I'm only going to take a few leaves. Don't want to deprive the other animals of their food, but not that many animals like to eat this. Just on a different subject, this is called a weeping wattle. And it's very, very soft, very smooth. There's no thorns on it. So can you think what you might use this for if you were stuck out in the bush and you weren't very well prepared? And let's say maybe you desperately needed to go to the bathroom. This is what you could use as toilet paper. So it's also known as the toilet paper tree by guides out here. And I nearly walked into that. That would have been exceptionally painful, but very funny if I had. So that's sort of how elephants eat. Sometimes, if they're feeling really hungry, what they will do is they will actually reach with their trunks, grab it, but put it straight in their mouth. So pull it to their mouth and just go, and bite it like that. They also drink using their trunks. Because imagine if an elephant had to bend right down to drink the water. It would be almost impossible. So what they do is they slurp up the water using their trunk, but they don't drink it through their trunk. They just, like a straw, they pull it up, but then they put the tip in their mouth and they breathe out again. And all of that water goes into their mouth and down into their throat. Now, I'm not really very big, so wandering about in the bush, especially in midwinter when it's very cold, I don't think I would enjoy very much. But Lauren, you were wondering, do elephants have shelter? And the answer is no, they don't need it. The smaller babies will cuddle up nice and close to their moms and their siblings and their cousins. I said to you that they're a very close family. So the small babies that might get more cold than the rest of the group will cuddle together for warmth. But elephants, because they're so big, they actually don't lose heat all that easily. So they don't really get too cold. And that combined with their big thick skin, they don't need to worry about having shelter. They're perfectly safe wandering about outside. And none of the animals, or a lot of the animals, don't actually live in shelter. Some of them do. Some of them live in tunnels and burrows in the ground. But most of them live out in the open. A warthog might live in a burrow, and a dwarf mongoose might live in a burrow, but elephants definitely don't need to. And I'm trying to look for a nice burrow to show you. They're quite often in these big termite mounds. Nope, no homes of animals there. Henry, you were wondering, do lions eat elephants? Sometimes, but it's very, very unusual and not really in this area that we're in now. There's so many other things for a lion to eat that they don't want to risk getting hurt by attacking something as big as an elephant. Lions would definitely think twice before tackling any kind of elephant because the rest of the herd will try to protect it. Speaking of lions, I wonder how Brent's search for the lions is going and whether or not he's found any evidence that they've been through. Let's go and have a look.
So, unfortunately, no lions, but we do have lion footprints.
Now this is a
big male lion track here. And if we get down, oh, let me get the shadow out the way. You can see there's the track there. And if I put my hand next to it and make a print, you can see how big it is. And I'm a big guy. I'm 6'3", and that lion track is the same size as the inside of my hand. So if we take a circle like this around the lion track, and we do that around the inside of my palm, it's bigger than the inside of my hand. So this is a very big male. He's part of our main group of male lions. A group of male lions is called a coalition. And a coalition of lions can be made up of unrelated males, and they get together so they can protect and defend a bigger area, and they can have more girlfriends. So they can be in charge of more than one pride of females. This particular coalition of males, there's four of them, they're called the Birmingham Boys, and they are in charge of two different groups of females. Okay, so they're around. Hopefully we can find them, but those tracks are unfortunately going across our northern boundary. So you can see this big road here. This is our boundary. So the nice thing about this part of the bush is there's no fences. So even though we can't drive over there, the animals can go wherever they want. And we're part of an 11 million acre unfenced area that's just for wild animals. And of course us on safari. Well, Ember would like to know if there's more than one type of lion. And there's a lot of argument about that. A lot of people have described subspecies, but generally there's only considered to be two different types of lions, the African lion and the Asiatic lion. So like the elephants, there's an African one and there's an Asian one. The Asian ones are very endangered. I know you guys have just done a project on endangered species, and they are only about, I think, about 700 or 800 of them left in the wild in the Gir Forest National Park in India. So the Asiatic lion and the African lion. VM said some more tracks. But these ones are a little bit older. So we were with them here. Yeah, they've been up and down along this road. So there's always a good chance that they might pop back, especially if they get chased by elephants. So Zion's wondering, do elephants attack lions? They do, Zion. They'll attack any predator. They'll attack a leopard, hyena. Not so much attack as chase away. But if they manage to grab one, they would definitely hurt it. And Jamie was just saying how a lion would think twice about attacking an elephant. But it's a very interesting thing that animals, even though they're the same species like lion, might behave differently in a different area. So in a part of Botswana where there's lots and lots and lots of elephants, there's a pride of lions that has learnt how to hunt elephants, but it is very, very rare. So while we continue to search for the lions, let's go back to Jamie, who's on Cheetah Plains, a different area of the reserve.
We've arrived, and I hear that you guys have been studying endangered animals. Sorry, I want to know why they're shouting. What I was going to say was I hear that you've been doing projects on endangered animals, and what I wanted to tell you was this is not an endangered species. These are antelope called impala, but they can be food for endangered species, and one type of cat in particular that I'm looking for out here, and that is the cheetah. But now, that alarm call that they're making, that bah, bah sound, that's them alarm calling at something. Now, I think that they've just got a bit confused. I think they're alarm calling at what was a warthog that's now gone into hiding. But just in case it is the rare and endangered cheetah, we're going to go forward a little bit so that we can see where they're looking and what's got them so upset. Oh, apparently it could have been us, actually. It's unusual. Just on high alert and looking. Ah, that's, yep, there we go. It's definitely him. They've got confused. They think down a little bit. There you go. There, have a look at that. That's what they're alarm calling at, silly impala. That warthog isn't going to hurt them. He's a vegetarian. And at the moment, he's actually having a mud bath. But because he's hidden where they can't see him properly, I think they thought he was a leopard coming to sneak up on them. Maybe even a cheetah or a lion. Now, this is called a warthog, like Pumbaa in The Lion King. Here he's coming wandering towards us. This is a very big warthog. And the reason that I know it's a male is, first of all, his tusks are absolutely huge, but also those things sticking out of the side of his face. He's got four of them. They kind of look like warts, which is where the name warthog comes from. And you only see four of them on a male. The females have two. And he's really big and bristly. Now he's covered in mud. Now obviously, even though we are in the middle of winter, In South Africa, our midwinter days can go right up to the mid-70s in Fahrenheit, which is where we're sitting at today, and the sun's actually quite strong. And that's why we are seeing the animals spending a bit of time in the water. I feel as though he's coming towards us, Dave. He's actually, oh, there he's running away a little bit. He keeps coming a bit closer and a bit closer, and then he runs away once again. Everybody says warthogs are ugly. I don't think that's very fair. I don't think they're ugly at all. I think they're actually wonderful animals. And they are very big and very powerful. They're part of the pig family, which you can see. They do look a little bit like domestic pigs, just a bit more wild and a bit more Africanized. Now, as he starts to scare the impala away, I spoke earlier about the fact that we've come here to look for cheetah. And Logan, you were wondering, how fast does a cheetah run? And the answer is between around 60 to 70 miles per hour. Look at the, he's not intentionally chasing the impala. They're just running away from him because he is so big and scary looking. Logan, between 60 and 70 miles per hour, but only over a very short distance, and only for a very short period of time. They're kind of like the Olympic sprinters that can only really run 100 meters really fast, or maybe 200 meters really fast. But other than that, they don't quite have the stamina to keep going any further. So that's why it's so important that a cheetah, when it's hunting, gets as close as possible to the animals that it's trying to hunt before it launches its attack and starts running towards them. Because an impala might not be exactly as fast as a cheetah, but they can run close to 60 miles per hour, and they've got lots more stamina. So they can keep running like that for far longer. I'm trying to show you the male warthog, the male impala. Now, he's gonna stay hidden, but we've actually got our warthog. If I go forward, sorry, Dave, I've got the warthog still. And Jashawn has a question about him, so I want to try and show him one last time. He's scratching at the back there. Oh, no, don't go, don't go. Oh, I tried, but he just decided he was going to disappear. He's walked just out of the reach of the camera. Well, I can still answer Jashawn's question while we have a look at the impala instead. But Jashawn's question is about a warthog. And he'd like to know if those funny things on the side of a warthog's face are used for digging. And that's a very good question, because warthogs do spend a lot of time digging. They like to eat roots and various parts of the plants that are underground, where the water and the nutrients are protected. But in this case, no. A warthog will use the tip of its nose to dig, or its feet, or the tusks that it has on the edge of its face. Those bumps on either side serve two purposes. One is to protect his eyes and the rest of his face when he fights with another male warthog over a female. And the fights can be pretty vicious. And then, along with those huge tusks, they kind of serve like a way of getting all dressed up to impress a girl. So the bigger his warts, they're not actually warts, but the bigger they are on the side of his face, the more attractive the lady warthogs find it. So the further and further away those projections on either side of his face go, the more the ladies appreciate it, because then they think that he's going to give them good genetics to pass on to their babies, and they'll be more likely to mate with him. So the bigger the warts, the better the warthog. And I'm just trying to get us one last view. I think we're going to move on, actually, just because I'm hoping to keep looking for the cheetah. But while we drive, Lauren, now that we've talked about what makes a good warthog male, for the female warthogs, you are right in that only the female warthogs will look after the piglets. Only the females watch the piglets, and the males generally will go off and do their own thing, and they don't really stick around all that much. But warthogs can be a bit more complicated than that, because sometimes the male does come and join the female and his babies. And if something like a leopard tries to attack, there is a good chance that he will try and protect them from that attack. So whilst he doesn't really play a big role in looking after his little ones, he will step up every now and again to help to protect them. I hear that Brent was showing you the size of a lion track. I'm now looking to see if I can't find you a nice elephant track and you can get an idea. Brent was using his hand to give you a sense of scale. Now with an elephant track, that would be almost impossible. My hand would just look ridiculously small on it. And instead, I would have to use my foot. These aren't very clear. No, I'm sure I can find you a better elephant track than these. These have been walked all over by impala and other things. Logan, you were wondering why it is that a cheetah has spots. There's two different big cats out here with spots. One is a leopard and one is a cheetah. And both of them have spots for exactly the same reason. They have spots because spots make it harder for the animals to see them. Now, in this time that you've been with me, I hope I haven't, but there's a very good chance that I could have already driven past a leopard hiding in the bushes. Their camouflage is some of the best in the world. Now, I'm keeping my fingers crossed that I can find a leopard or a cheetah for you. And then I can show you properly just how well that camouflage does work. But the spots are there. What it does is, especially out here in this vegetation, it breaks up the outline of the animal. So they don't look, it's not like a solid shape creeping forward. The dots make it look like basically just part of the grass or part of the leaves of the trees. And I've walked past a leopard that was a meter away from me before, and a meter is 3 feet, and I didn't see it, and I only saw it afterwards, and I just kept walking because leopards would prefer it, especially that close, if you didn't look at them. They prefer to think that they haven't been seen. They like to play secretive and hidden. A very good question from Lauren. I didn't explain earlier because I got distracted by showing you just how an elephant eats. Lauren wants to know, why is it called a weeping wattle? And the answer is because it's related to a type of tree called a wattle tree. Wattle, W-A-T-T-L, wattle tree, not a waffle tree like a waffle that you eat. And then the reason it's called weeping is actually an amazing story. And I'm trying to find one for you now to show you. You hardly ever get to see it, but in summer, there's a type of insect called a spittle bug. Spittle like spit. And what they do is they gather in huge numbers all around the weeping wattle. And there's one for you there. Here we go, a light gray in color. And it's this one with the fine feathery leaves there. There we go, keep going a little bit to the left. There we go. Perfect, yeah, that's the one straight ahead. Up a little bit. These ones, yeah, both of these. This is the weeping wattle. It's a beautiful tree. And what the spittlebugs do is they tap at the sap, and because they drink so much of the tree sap, they start to excrete lots and lots of it onto the ground, and it looks like the tree is crying. That is why it's called the weeping wattle. Now, Lauren, There you go, an answer to your question. Now, you wanted to know about spots and why a cheetah have them. Well, there's another type of camouflage out here that works really well, and that is stripes. And Brent has found some stripy horses for you.
Look at this. It's a young zebra having a snooze in the road ahead of us. And Jamie has just been talking about camouflage in leopards. Now, to us, a zebra doesn't look very camouflaged at all. Black and white sticks out like a bit of a sore thumb. But if you have to see a zebra through the bush, those stripes help break up the outline. And you've got to remember, lions and leopards don't see in color like we do. They see in grays and blacks and whites. So if everything's gray, black and white, having black and white stripes is very good camouflage. Let's see if we can sneak a little bit closer. So Zion's wondering, do all female zebras have the same amount of stripes? No, each individual zebra is completely separate, so no one zebra has the exact same stripes or amount of stripes. There we go, there's the rest of them. And they all look very fat. Now that's because of their digestive system, their hind gut fermenters. So you can never tell if a zebra is in bad condition by looking at how big its belly looks, because they always look fat. Let's just try and move a little bit forward and I'll show you how you can tell if a zebra is not in the best condition. Oh, there's someone to walk across the road in front of us. So if we, there we go. So if we look at their mane, let's go have a look. Whoop. So on their neck, you can see that bit of hair that's sticking up straight on their neck. Let me just find, see there, along the back there. So that's called their mane. And if their mane is floppy in places, it means they're not in very good condition. So all these zebras are looking very fit and healthy. There's the little one who was having a snooze just now. And you can see all their fly swats working overtime. So most animals have a tail to try keep the flies away. Now, that's most animals that eat grass and leaves. Now, if we think about monkeys, well, a monkey's tail is very important for balance while they're jumping through a tree, and so is it for a baboon. And for a cheetah and a lion and leopard as well, the tails have, well, more importantly for a cheetah than anything else, have a balance. It helps them balance when they run incredibly fast, and they can run nearly 70 miles an hour. The cheetah. I know Jamie's looking for cheetah, so we're going to keep looking for the other big cats. Unfortunately, it seems like the lions have done a disappearing act, so we'll try and find a leopard. But as Jamie's just said, they're really hard to spot because of their camouflage. Michaela would like to know, how did I know it was a male lion paw print? Because of how big it was, Michaela. The females are quite a bit smaller than that. So that male paw print was that big. A female's would probably fit inside my palm. Alex has got a very interesting question. What is the normal number in a herd of zebra? Well, Alex, it completely depends on the area. In this area, the normal number is anything from 5 to about 20. We very seldom get bigger herds than that, but east of us here, on the flat, grassy basalt plains of the Eastern Kruger National Park, it's not uncommon at this time of the year to get a herd of 100. Sorry guys, I thought I spotted something. It was a little mongoose who ran away very quickly. So when you're out in the bush, you not only do you use your eyes to find animals, you use your nose and your ears. And probably the most important one is your ears. By knowing the different animals' sounds and what sounds different animals make when they see another animal also helps. So all the animals that get eaten by lions and leopards will normally make an alarm call. So you can imagine it's like shouting a warning to your friend. So you can imagine, so an impala sees a leopard, they start snorting. And what they're doing, and I know you saw them get confused and snort at a warthog, but when they start snorting at a leopard like that, what they're telling all the other animals is that there's a leopard, leopard, leopard. But my favorite, I think, is the baboons. And I saw some baboon tracks now, and I'm hoping we might see them. Now, they're very funny animals to watch. But when a baboon sees a lion or a leopard, he climbs up to the top of the tree and he shouts, so everyone in the bush can hear. He goes, "Lion! Lion!" And then all the other animals will pay attention and they know that there's a potential predator in the area. Well, it's been wonderful having Mrs. Coffin's North Landing class on Drive with us. And don't forget, guys, to join us on safari again soon. But for now, bye-bye, and we'll see you soon. Welcome back to everyone else, and lovely to be with you on this beautiful late summer's afternoon. You can see not a cloud in the sky and not a lion in the land. But Jamie's got a wonderfully beautiful little bird to show you.
Yeah. Isn't this absolutely beautiful? And with this camera, we can get right up close and personal to a bird that I like to think of as the springbuck bird, since it is the colors of our springbuck rugby team. I hope, come back, no, don't disappear. It's also known officially, much more officially, as the little bee eater. Well spotted there, Dave. And we've got two of them. And in fact, one of them just caught something in mid-flight. Absolutely lovely. Such a striking bird with those bright greens and yellows. And then if you look really carefully, just that hint of blue eyeshadow almost. Like they've put on a bit of makeup. They've gone a little bit heavy-handed on the eyeliner. Then just a tint of blue or the eyeshadow. And you can see those rapid head movements, constantly casting about or any flying insects. In sync there, almost perfectly for a moment. Obviously, as their name suggests, the smallest of the bee eater family. And one that sticks around with us, like the white-fronted, and unlike the European and the carmine bee eaters, these little bee eaters stick around all year round, and at the moment they're taking advantage of the last few butterflies and insects that are hanging about. And they're called the springbuck bird not just because of their coloration, but also because of their hunting style. Oh, you missed a butterfly there. I saw it. I saw it flutter behind you there. Guards using their tail to constantly keep balance. But yes, their hunting style often is a sort of an upwards-downwards flight. They fly up and then attack from above, catch the insect, and then use that long bill to sweep it from side to side and to kill whatever it is they happen to get. And in the case of bees, as the name bee eater suggests, to remove the stricken honeybee used to be called the African killer bee, somewhat unfairly as it happens, because it's no more of a killer than any other bee. And as you know, bees are something that have become incredibly endangered throughout the world and yet are so essential to our survival. And one of the main pollinators of most of our main crop foods, whether it be maize or corn or whatever else happens to be the starch of choice in different corners of the globe. And the African killer bee earned a rather unfair reputation as being incredibly aggressive, and they're not aggressive bees. They will defend their hives, just like any other animal will try and defend its home. And as a result, they've been unfairly labelled, but that has changed now to the African honeybee. The Mopani bee, on the other hand, is something very similar to a fly, and they're very fond of us as human beings, especially in this drought period, because they like to settle down upon our skin and take whatever moisture they can from our sweat. There are plenty of those around, and whilst we try not to swat them, every now and again when they crawl into your ear or into the corner of your eye to try and get to the tear ducts, you do sort of feel a little bit as though they're in your personal space. And this little bee eater has been incredibly obliging. Perched here, not quite as active as his companion, his or her companion, who is a little bit further to the left. Ooh, and of course now to describe that to Dave is next to impossible, and in fact I've now lost track of where I am almost completely. If you go a bit further to the left, Dave, past that silver cluster leaf and there and in, you start zooming in, I'll be able to show you where it is. You're in the right ballpark, and there we go. You should be able to see it in the middle of your screen, or almost in the middle. There we go. Well done, Dave.
Thank you, Jamie.
Can't you, you know, I've done that to the cameraman so many times, and somehow I always manage to do it to Gendre in particular. I stop and I think that he's seen it, and I'll go, look at that bird. And he looks at me in utter panic, as if to say, what bird? I haven't seen it. You know, make poor Dave spot the bright, very tiny, bright green bird that's exactly the same color as all of the leaves in the trees. But we got it.
Yeah.
We got it. We did get it. And I think it's time to move on and go and search for those cheetah that apparently crossed into Mala Mala. Well, if they are on Mala Mala, we're incredibly fortunate in that, of course, we have this phenomenal zoom lens, or zoom camera. There you go, there's my official cameraman terminology. Sorry about that. Dave's saying well done. There's just the slightest sarcastic hint there, Dave. There's a buffalo thorn ahead of us, Dave. Speaking of our springbuck bird, I would never put Dave in a buffalo thorn.
Oh, please don't,
Not intentionally, I would never. Not intentionally, I have done it by mistake before. Now, Dean, you were wondering quickly why, in the subject of our springbuck bird, why it is that there are no springbuck in the Kruger National Park, and you're from Nelspruit. The answer is it's adaptation and competition. So as basically fulfilling the same ecological niche as the impala, but being better adapted to desert areas, arid areas, the springbuck have found their niche towards the area within the more arid Kalahari regions, whereas the impala have made this their niche. But they're very similar sized antelope, very similar diet, and as a result they're in too much competition to be in exactly the same place without impacting negatively on the ecology of the area. And this Africa has 72 different species of antelope throughout the continent. 72 antelope species. Because, first of all, we've got such a vast variety of different habitats, but but also because they've got such incredibly adaptable physiological conditions, or can adapt to such different ecological conditions. They can change the way in which their stomach digests, they can change, certain species can change the way they respond to water retention, and all of that has meant that they can utilize pretty much every ecological niche that there is out here for an antelope. Now, bear with me for 1 second. Brent has been trying to get hold of me on the Game Drive channel apparently, so I'm just going to respond to him. Brent for Jamie. See if I can't find you something nice to look at. Brent, please go again with that message. Brent. My Game Drive channel doesn't want to work terribly well. I'm sorry. I know this is distracting for all of you, but it's an important part of the way in which we communicate. I'm sure he has a very important message for me.
Definitely.
I'm struggling a little bit to hear. And at the moment, somebody else has jumped in and has the possibility of having a conversation. So I'll try in a moment to contact Brent. And while I do, speaking of Brent, he has found another elephant for you. So let's head across into Juma.
Welcome back, everyone. And as you can see, we're with a breeding herd of elephants, but we've got a young boy. He's busy moving all the dead wood to get to the grass underneath. Oh, there we go. You can see he's found some grass under that dead marula. Clever boy. So we're on the edge of the breeding herd. So there's a group of little boys here right on the periphery. Sounds like the rest of the herd's just up ahead. There are the other two boys. Now, incredible creatures. You can see the rest of the breeding herd popping through behind. Lael in Washington is wondering, how long does a matriarch or the older female lead the herd? Is it just a few years or a couple of years? For quite an extended period, I mean, well over 30, sometimes up to 30 years. There's a big bull behind us as well on the other side of the little riverbed. We can't really see him. We'll show him a bit later, try to catch up with him. But you can see how elephants with their enormous strength are able to move, I mean, full trees to get to the grass hidden underneath that's been protected from all the other browsers.
Oh dear, it seems as though Brent has disappeared off your screens once again. But we have arrived at a lovely open clearing that Cheetah Plains is, of course, famous for, and let us see what's happening here in the great open area of Cheetah Plains. Well, there's our wildebeest herd for a start, as well as the buffalo in front of us, so bear with me 1 second, you'll have a view in a moment. We'll be able to stop and have a look. Just an overview at first. All of the different animals that we've got hanging about here. Do you know, I haven't actually seen that many Dugger boys on Cheetah Plains before. I've seen far more of them around Juma. That being said, I think that with the slow disappearance, oh wow, Dave, look at that elephant at the back. He's huge. He's right at the back. walking in that clear patch behind the thicket of trees.
Oh, yes.
Right at the back. Here we go, thank you. I know it's very difficult for you to tell, and I drew your attention away from the buffalo there for a moment, just because that bull is absolutely enormous. And I'm hoping, on the subject of water, that he's on his way here to drink as well. We'll have to just give him a little bit of time to come through. Hello, boy. I know that Brent had a stunning encounter with some elephant bulls around this area. He looks like he might be in the early stages of must. And what we're seeing more and more with the drought as a, not really a positive, yes, it is a positive, it's a positive for us, is that we're getting more of these enormous bulls coming in from the Kruger National Park. And you are basically looking across into the Kruger National Park as we speak. There's our wildebeest herd, always up to amusing antics. The last time Dave and I saw them together, they were being stalked by the two male cheetah that hang out in this area. The school kids earlier, as you know, cheetah can't really sustain its burst of speed, so it had to try and get a little bit closer before they can launch an attack. They're peacefully grazing off in the distance. Now, I have been, just to update you on that conversation, since it might be a bit disjointed from your side, I've been trying to contact Brent on the Game Drive channel. Unfortunately, I don't think he's hearing me. I'll be listening with one ear to whatever's happening on that side. It sounds as though Karula, from where I tracked her out this morning, might well be coming back across the southern boundary of our territorial, no, not our territorial, our territorial area. We're not territorial at all, but we do have a set traverse area. So hopefully she'll come back and pay us a visit this afternoon or this evening. Exciting prospects. At some point, I will come back and rejoin this wildebeest herd and spend a bit of time with them, just because I personally find wildebeest endlessly entertaining. But for now, since the scene doesn't look as though it's going to change terribly much, I just want to go towards the southern boundary and see if we can't get a view of those cheetah. We didn't manage to get there this morning, and I'm quite excited to go and see if we can't spot them from the boundary of Mana Mana. So let's carry on for now. And if they aren't there, then we can always come back and spend a bit more time in this region. And of course, there's always the possibility of Inkanyeni, the female leopard that is based in this area, and her two cubs of around 5 months, close to 6 months old now. They were seen for the first time on our live drives not terribly long ago. I have yet to see them. Dave, have you seen them? Yes, you have seen them. You can walk home. You can walk home. Go. It's that way. I'm getting very jealous now.
Let's find them, Jimmy.
Yes, let's find them. I like that. Good thinking. And Joseph, who is watching all the way in Wales, which is, I really like Wales, just by the way. Very fond of the place, and I have some very, very good friends from Wales. You were wondering which of the big cats is the best at climbing and which is the best at swimming. Let's start with climbing, and we're talking purely in this region. A leopard would be absolutely hands down the best climber. Oh yes, as a big cat. You did specify big cat, didn't you? Yes, you did. A caracal is also an exceptionally good arboreal cat. Can spend a lot of time in trees. So a caracal is quite good, but as for the big cats, leopard hands down the best climbers. Lions are, they can climb trees, they are not very good at it, and they very often fall out of the trees that they're trying to climb in. A leopard definitely outskills them in that sense, and the cheetah can also climb trees, but with its only semi-retractable claws and quite bluntened claws, it's limited in the way in which it climbs, and really limited to the lower branches and the bigger branches of the trees. I have, however, seen cheetah right up very high in a marula tree before. In terms of swimming, if I had to, I would probably say again, just in terms of its physical strength for its body size, a leopard probably takes that medal as well, but it's a very close contest because all three of the big cats can swim. Cheetah does show quite a bit of reluctance to do so, but they're very happy to wade across the river. Lions as well will also go barreling into a dam if they think it means they can catch something, if they're chasing prey, for example. But leopards are known to actively, there are some leopards in particular, individuals, that have specialized in hunting into the dams, going into the dams and catching catfish or barbel. Again, but now we're talking purely in this area because, of course, there's the tiger, and the tiger is famous for its swimming abilities and, in fact, really enjoys spending time in water. And the Asian or the Russian fishing cat, which doesn't quite fall under the Panthera genus of the big cats, but is nevertheless quite a large cat, considering. That's to broaden our description a little bit in terms of the best swimmers. Yay, ostriches! And wildebeest on our right, and zebra on our right. Sorry, Dave, that was my fault. And then ostriches on our left. Sorry, Dave. There's just so many things happening, I don't know where to look. You're gonna keep Dave guessing. We're going to get there soon. We can creep up relatively close. They are on our side of the reserve this time around, which means that we can go and say hello to them. And of course, there's always the possibility of a stalking cheetah coming up on the other side. Now, that is something I think that would be absolutely, for me, the pinnacle of what we could see on this plain. Would be a cheetah chasing an ostrich in this open area. That would pretty much make my week. Not necessarily catching the ostrich, but just that chase, to see two animals built for speed, sprinting at full tilt across the open area, would just be incredible. We're getting there. I don't want to do any damage to this open area by driving off-road, so, and also they're quite skittish. So we'll stop here with our pride or wobble of ostriches. Such bizarre animals. There's a group of females, a harem of females, and then the much more striking male at the back. There he is there. Oh, you can even get to see those incredible toes. Oh, where are we going? There's a certain elegance to their movements. I'm not sure how many of you have ever watched Fantasia, the Disney movie Fantasia. There's a wonderful scene there, and I can't remember which piece of music it is, but it's basically, it starts with ostriches as ballet dancers. And it was one of my favorite scenes in Fantasia as a child, and it remains so. You can kind of see it with their elegance, the way that they step, and those very powerful long limbs and very extended necks. And they're a bit like giraffe. The more you look at them, the more bizarre they become. Those ridiculous little wings that no longer really serve much of a purpose except to make them look bigger and scarier when they need to, when they puff themselves up. Not sure how many of you have ever been hissed at by an ostrich, but a hissing, puffed up ostrich can be quite the intimidating thing. Oh, there was a big neck roll there by the male. Long-limbed and very, very fast. The biggest bird in the world. It's very hard for you guys maybe to get a sense of scale unless you have seen ostriches before. It's very tricky. But to give you a rough idea, I'm about 5'7", and an ostrich's head is probably about close to half a foot taller than me, if not even more so. Probably close to Brent in height. That's like Brent's size. They're very tall, and that makes them relatively intimidating. They've been known to chase people, and I actually know a few people towards the Eastern Cape that have guard ostriches instead of guard dogs. Just kind of like some people have guard geese. I don't know if any of you have ever encountered somebody with a goose guarding their property, but ostriches can do the same, and they have been known to very aggressively deter intruders, and they can kick both forwards and to an extent backwards, mostly forwards though, even out sideways. And that large toe in the front, somewhat not quite reminiscent of the raptor claw of the velociraptors, but when you're being threatened by it, it kind of feels that way. Very sharp and very large. Very warm welcome to Paul, who has said this is very cool, and that he doesn't remember seeing so many ostrich together like this before. Are they related? And Paul, they could be, to an extent. It could be a family of, but it's unlikely at this point. Now, ostriches have a couple of different approaches to family rearing, and it depends very much on the area that you're in. Some of them are relatively monogamous, where there's a limited supply of ostriches. They'll live together in mated pairs and they'll raise their offspring. So we might be looking at that, because some of the more mottled individuals, the female colored individuals, are a little bit smaller than the adults. So they might be...
Can anybody in the east after the west copy me?
Sorry, everybody. I've been doing some radio tests at the same time here. Yes, Peter, I copy you. Rushing about, looking intimidating. Paul, I'm sorry, I got distracted from your question. Ostriches can also have a harem. In other words, the male can have more than one female. And judging by his distinct look of pride and slight smugness, I think that might be the case here. I'm exaggerating, of course. I think he has gathered together his harem, and this is a group. So I think it's a group of unrelated females. They might not all be mating with this male, but ostriches are gregarious. Safety in numbers. Ooh, they're doing their dance. This is very cool. You know, I think it might be mating time. I think it is. I think it's breeding season for ostriches, or close to breeding season for ostriches. And that's, I think, why we're getting this lovely display every now and again, with their wings out. Look at those two. They look like they're dancing together. In the breeding season, the male will become flushed and red around the face and the legs, which we can't see at the moment yet. However, there's always a prelude before one goes into an actual breeding season. Just like how we saw with the male impala, they started fussing and making a noise and running about like they were full of energy, let's put it that way, way before the females were nearly ready to mate. So this might be the prelude to the breeding season. He hasn't got that full breeding season flush just yet. And now it's all over. Everybody's gone. Oh, they're playing musical statues. Almost. That's what it looks like. They danced around each other and then everybody froze completely. Except for that one on the right. She's lost the game. Oh, the next one gone, next one gone. Okay, so the male was the winner of that game of musical statues. That was really interesting that they all went as still as they did. And I suppose it's all part of the same process known as allomet mimicry. We see it in the smaller passerines, the babblers, for example. They all start, as soon as one starts to call, the others do. In this case, you can almost think of that behavior as herd behavior. Like when one impala starts to alarm call, and then the others start to follow, even though they haven't actually seen what the threat is that they're meant to be alarm calling at. So as soon as one bird goes still and focuses its attention, I think that's why the others followed along. Just have a look there at the perspective of size. That male, I know he's a little bit behind the female, but he does actually look quite a bit smaller than her. At least the first female next to him on his right. He's not that far away from her. Chitra, welcome. You're watching in India, and hello to you too. We would like to know, at what speed do ostriches run? And the answer is they can get right up to close to 70, maybe even 80 kilometers an hour on a good day. So for those of you working in miles, that would be around 40 to 50 miles per hour, possibly even faster at times. An ostrich can, with a serious burst of speed, can match and even outrun a cheetah, which means that if pushed, they could go right up to the 70 mile per hour mark. That would be an absolute fastest possible. There we go. That common trait of all birds, which is excreting their urea in solid form rather than liquid form of urine, as mammals do. That initial burst was urea, the rest was just defecation. Just to describe what an ostrich feather feels like, I'm sure most of you are familiar, but it's very soft and very fluffy. It's not like a feather that is adapted for flight, which is quite well reinforced and very solid. An ostrich feather, you can clearly see, does not in any way serve a flight purpose at all. As we start to potentially go into the ostrich breeding season, Hilda, you were wondering where and how an ostrich will nest. And, aggression from the female there. She provoked that attack. I don't quite know why. Hold on a second, sorry. We'll get back to the nest in question once this behavior has played itself out. And there's competition there amongst the females. That initially did not was not in any way provoked by the actions of the males, or the action of the one male. It was a female that went barreling in there and disrupted the group. Oh, and back to musical statues again. And pose for screenshot. Oh, no, you moved. You in the right, at the back, you moved. Okay. Here we go, some interesting... We're learning a little bit here about ostrich behavior. Back to Hillman's question about where they nest. They nest on the ground in hollows that they have dug out, kind of like a lapwing nest, if you've been watching, if you're a regular viewer of the safari live safaris. Kind of like an ostrich, a lapwing nest, just about, you know, 30 times bigger or so. And their enormous eggs are guarded, and both the male and the female will take turns in guarding their nests. And what they will do, if you've got a group of females like this, is they will all nest in a close vicinity to each other, so that they can, some of them can go off foraging for a while, go off looking for food, and then return to the nests and leave them in the capable claws, I guess, of other ostriches to protect. They also, at the heat of the day, ostriches are birds that are well adapted for a desert area, an arid area, and you find them throughout Africa in some of the southern African deserts, in Namibia and in Botswana. And there's places like that where the temperatures are will easily skyrocket to over 40 degrees, so well over 110 degrees Fahrenheit. So what the ostriches in that case will do is they'll actually shade the nests. They'll stand over it with their wings outspread, and I'm sure many of you are picking up on the fact that this wind has suddenly come billowing out of nowhere. So that's what you're hearing, gusting over the plains. Peggy is saying that she's so looking forward to seeing baby ostriches and the way in which the fathers protect them. Absolutely, I agree with you. The fathers are very involved in the family of young ostrich lives. They do protect them, they do keep them safe, and they can be quite vigorous and aggressive defenders of their families. Now, baby ostrich is probably one of the cutest things, one of the cutest baby birds. Oh, here we go again. Not quite as dramatic as the last time. Everybody had their wings spread out and danced around. It's like some kind of form of expressive dance. So Piggy, he's absolutely right. The father is very defensive of their chicks. Oh, I was talking about how cute they are. They don't look anything like the adults. They're funny, cryptically colored little things that run around on their long legs, but not perfect miniatures of the adults. They've got mottled, very mottled coloring, almost like, what's the closest description? They're actually spotted, kind of like the approach followed by crested Franklins or by spur fowls in terms of coloration, are very, very different to the adults. And that's, of course, an adaptation to remaining hidden and protected during the most vulnerable time of their lives. The other thing that some of you may not know is that ostriches are capable of roaring and booming. It really sounds like a lion roar. It is the most incredible sound, and I hope that one day we will be able to show it to you. The most likely time that we will hear that and see it will be around the actual breeding season, so when they are ready to breed. We shall have to wait and see. Now, Rebecca would like to know, how many eggs will be in the average clutch of an ostrich? And how large are they? They're about 20 times the size of a chicken egg, to give you a rough example. I think I read somewhere you could fit about 20 chicken eggs inside one ostrich egg. Clutch size, I would be, if I'm totally honest, I would be sucking the number out of my thumb. I don't know the answer to the average ostrich egg clutch size. As far as I know, and if I had to guess, I'd say between 10 to 15 eggs, with 15 being quite a large number, 10 probably, maybe 8 to 10 being the average. I have seen ostriches with lots of little babies barreling about their ankles. So I know that it's not a, you're not sitting around 2 or 3, you're probably sitting at around 10. Oh, goodness. Ladies. Comport yourselves with dignity. Very unimpressed with each other at the moment. Now, this might not even be connected to breeding. It just might be a harem hierarchical battle. Just like zebra occasionally nip and bite each other, that might also be an explanation behind the behavior that they're exhibiting here. No, it's not necessarily just a breeding thing. But on the subject of breeding, Chitra, how long do ostriches incubate their eggs for? If I'm not very much mistaken, it's up to 3 months. I'm not 100% sure on that, Chitra, and I will get back to you on it. I have to confess, I've never closely followed an ostrich breeding cycle before. I've never been fortunate enough. I've seen lots of ostriches and I've been chased by lots of ostriches, but I've never had the pleasure of observing the full life cycle in the same way I have with anything from lions to leopards to rhino, for example, with the bigger mammals. I haven't managed to have the same opportunity with ostriches, so I'm not 100% on the incubation period of an ostrich's eggs. I guessed at around 3 months, and it is around 42 days, so that's much less than 3 months. 42 days is just over a month. Wow, that's impressive. My apologies, it's not 3 months, it's close to 42 days, so about close to a month and a half. It will be their incubation period. So much shorter than a bird of prey would be, which is interesting. Oh, are we going to go again for the... Yep. See how it's all provoked by that female. I'm not sure whether you saw her hiss there in that brief moment. She had her beak wide open as she provoked that attack. It's not an attack. It was more of a little bit of a threat display. Attack is definitely too harsh a word to describe that. James Richards, who has been very diligently building up a record of all of the different tracks that we see out here through screenshots, and he really enjoys learning about their tracks. He wanted to know about roughly how large an adult male track is. The answer, let me just think about it, because I can give you it in terms of scale in reference to something, but I'm just trying to think of how I would compare that in terms of a measurement and then convert it into inches. About the size of my hand plus about a third of the way down my arm. Sorry, I'm busy sort of half talking to myself here, thinking about the last ostrich track I saw. So a big male would be, they're not as big as you think they are. So probably from the tips of my fingers to just below my wrist, and my hand is in inches, 8 inches long. There's a rough estimate for you. How about this? I will find you a track. I will find you an ostrich track and we will have a proper look at exactly how long it is and exactly how big it is. And actually, we should be able to, if we're lucky, we might even be able to find one on the road along the boundary, since we know that they very often come across from mile and mile. We just have to hope that all of the cheetah traffic... No, that's a stump, sorry. I was speaking of... Sorry. I convinced myself I saw a cheetah. It was not a cheetah. It was a log. Tucker, who is 4 years old, would like to know, with these huge birds, can they fly up really, really high? The amazing thing is that no, ostriches can't fly. They're actually too big and heavy, and their wings are too small for them to fly up, kind of like a dodo or an emu. They're just too heavy. So an ostrich actually cannot fly at all, and instead has learned to run really, really fast. I'm going to leave our ostriches now to their dancing and whatever else they have planned for their afternoon. And I'm going to go and look for the cheetah. In the meantime, I think Brent has found a signal patch again. So let's find out how his afternoon is going.
Wasn't that incredible? A bit of dancing ostriches. And Jamie was just describing how an ostrich can sometimes sound like a lion. And I have an ostrich. I'm going to hold it to my mic. You can hear, if you're not sure and at a distance, how it would sound like the low calls of a lion. Very sickly lion. But they have caught many, many people over the years. And as Jamie's just been saying, cheetahs are great fans of ostrich meat. So we're going to try to catch up with that big herd of ellies we had a little earlier. We're moving down towards the Mawati drainage out in some nice open air. So hoping they've come out of that thick stuff and we can get a nice view of them. Oh, before I forget, I've got some news. Vim, do you think I should tell them the news? I think we should make you wait.
Yes,
I've got news that is literally going to set Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. What else is social media?
That's about it.
Is that it? We're going to set the Safari Live social media alight with some news, but we're going to keep it from you for just a little longer. So why don't you try guess what news Vim and I are holding? And savoring, we're just going to savor it between us for a little longer. See if you can guess what that news is. If you can, drop me an email, questions@wildearth.tv, or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So those elephants were heading in this general direction. We just had a quick squiz around for one of the missing Birmingham males, but it looks like he has gone further east. So let's go find some pachyderms. And as always, I've got my eye, open for the nearly impossible tree quiz. Vim, how mean am I feeling? Out of? Five out of six, okay. VM's convinced me. There is your nearly impossible tree quiz for today. Something that has been completely munched on by caterpillars. And if we look, there are a few leaves still. Nice little green ones down at the bottom. But there's the nearly impossible tree quiz for today. What tree or bush is that? And again, answers to hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. I'm actually quite impressed with how evil we are, Vim. Or use the email address questions@wildearth.tv. Let's see, I think I got you guys, finally. And if it was too impossible, you're going to have to blame VM for saying I was feeling a 5 out of 6 mean today. So we also decided to check this road because I haven't been on it, I think, since I've been back from leave. It's always good to just have a perusal around, see what's been going on. Now, quite a special road. So the den Karula gave birth in is just off the edge, a little bit further down there. But she hasn't spent much time in this area since giving birth. Oh, hello, Quirrell. And if she was, that little guy would have been shouting at the top of his lungs. Off goes the squirrel. Now, the squirrels, hopefully for their sake, collected a lot of food for this dry season, but the tree squirrel does not really collect like the grey squirrel that you get in the northern hemisphere. So they don't have to survive as harsh a winter. So they will be foraging all winter. And as the bush thins out, hopefully not only will they be foraging, but they'll be spotting us leopards. Someone thinks, are we going to new territory? That's not it. It's even better, Donna. Junior is definitely not back, and that's not that exciting. This is even more exciting than if Junior came back. We're hoping those elephants were moving in this general direction, but they have popped out onto the open. They haven't just yet. So let's just go have a little listen. Maybe they're still up towards Weaver's Nest. Let's go up there. Kitty Kitty Bang Bang is wondering, does the elephant's tusk come through a hole in the upper lip? They come out of a socket, but basically the same as what you would have in all your teeth. You've got the canal, what's it called again now, Vim?
Like a dentist to you.
Yes, there we go, Vim. Do I look like a dentist to you? I'll remember the word now. But so basically it comes out of a very similar thing as all the other teeth. They're just modified and elongated. Now, speaking of elephants, where have they disappeared to? To Miss Gunn and Miss Gunn's fifth grade classroom. Hope you guys are doing well this evening, or this morning where you are, otherwise you wouldn't still be at school. Miss Gunn's class would like to know, how easy is it for an elephant to break its toenail? Well, toenails are really thick and they don't really break as opposed to wear, because they use them a lot when they're kicking up possible food, when they kick little plants and stuff out. So it's almost always worn, so they don't ever really get long enough for them to break. I've only ever seen one elephant with a really strange long toenail, actually more than one, but a couple, but it's very unusual. Then they might break, but then again, it's really hard and really difficult for them to break. Miss Lobo Bob is wondering, would any of the big cats go after a baby elephant? Most definitely, the only one would really be lions, and outside of that, hyenas. If a baby happened to wander a bit far or get left behind, then yes, they definitely would. Or even if they just straggle around the edge, the big cats are opportunists, and so are hyenas. So, oh, there we go, we caught up with them, they just went the other way. And there's a nice bull at the back. I thought I saw some dust. So this is how I like my afternoon traffic. Oh, I think this is going to be absolutely gorgeous with the backlight and the dust. Oh, there's some young boys fighting. Let's just get into position. Look at that. See all that dust they're kicking up. Boom! Can you hear the tusks? Oh, I hope you guys are gonna get some good green screenshots with this dust in the backlight. Oh, look at that, isn't that exquisite? Magic. So these are young elephant bulls, around 20. Oh, back in the road. You can hear that. Let's get a bit closer. You can hear those tusks clashing. And here we've got something very unusual. It's a tuskless bull. Now, you find tuskless cows quite often, but I've never seen a tuskless bull. I wonder if he's actually just broken his tusks. Doesn't look like it. Okay, well, let's catch up with the troublemakers. Just see the dust they're creating up ahead. So exciting. I really love Ellie's. They're the troublemakers. The rest of the herd's further ahead. So this isn't too serious, this is more play. Horn in the bottom. Smashing the bushes. Not a horn, a tusk. And there's the tuskless bull watching on. You can see he's physically quite a lot bigger. But of course, not having any tusks would be a little bit of a disadvantage. But I'm quite sure he'd be able to sort those two little ones out even without a tusk. He's so physically much bigger than they are. elephants all around us. So there seems to be a stalemate with these elephants at the moment. Let's go back and have a closer look. But wasn't that absolutely beautiful with all that dust? What's going on, lads? All over now? Friends again? No, maybe not. But as you can see, they are just playing at the moment. Oh, they're disappearing into the thickets there. We're going to try to catch up with the rest of the herd. While we do that, James was asking about that tuskless male and wondering, will that make it harder to find females? Oh, they had it again. James, I'll be back with your question in a second. Just listen. You can hear those tusks hit each other. Stalemate again. But every time we think it's over, it sparks up again. Sitting and waiting quietly in case that sparks up again. I want you to hear that massive clash of the tusks. But it looks like they've calmed down a bit. They should catch up with the rest of the herd. So what we're going to do is, while they're moving through this thick area, we're going to catch up with the rest of the herd. And James was asking about that tuskless male and whether... I spotted a leopard in a tree in the distance, but it was not. And whether it will make it difficult for him to find females. Finding the females isn't the problem, James. It's out competing the other big males. So he's at a disadvantage. If you have, if another male has tusks, imagine the damage he can inflict. Because normally, as we've just been seeing with the play fighting, is that those tusks lock and they take a lot of the force. Now imagine if you've got none of that blocking that force and that sharp object pointing straight into your face. That's where his problem is, rather than the finding of the females. He can find females, there's females everywhere. It's fighting off the other males for mating rights. We can just see this dust coming up ahead, and that's definitely from elephants. So let's go have a squiz. And you can see why those young males are kept on the edge of the breeding herds. All that testosterone rolled up into about 4,000 kilograms. I'm not sure. There's one elephant going through there. The dust seems to be over there. But let's try to figure out where they've gone. I'm hoping they're heading up towards quarantine. I think we could get some spectacular elephant silhouettes. Ah, there they are. Lenny is saying, we saw some young bulls fighting with Sam for an extended period. Would the matriarch break it up if she felt it had gone on for too long? Only if it disturbed the other elephants. If they want to fight and they're not causing too much trouble with other elephants, then she will just let it go on. Hello, mister. We seem to be around all the young bulls. That looks like a young bull pushing his luck with an adult female. Young bull with his bum to us, adult female in front. And that's when sometimes you hear that screaming. Let's go get a bit closer. What a beautiful big breeding herd. It's the same one we saw earlier. I'm estimating probably about 80 or 90 elephants in this group. And they're very, very much spread out. I mean, look at this. Well, Chitra from India is wondering, do they communicate by stomping their feet on the ground? They don't. They communicate through lots of various different sounds. Oh, we got some babies. Most of them are rumbles that are too deep for us to hear. And then also obviously there's trumpets and screams and roars. The elephants have a multitude of vocalizations available to them. But the main communication is a low. And that can be heard for up to about 20 kilometers between the elephants. Just heard it there. Large Namibian dove on at Philemon's Dip, slowly mobile north. Standing by, Andrew.
And then we're thinking maybe they might come out there, what is dam, if it's the water there, I'm not sure. So, just a heads up.
Copy, thanks very much, Andrew. I'll definitely make my way back inside area. Confirm, is there anyone with them at the moment?
There was no one. They were moving through the woods, so I have to turn around, and I think that there's a huge block for them to come out there. They must be still continue walking.
Sorry, guys. Andrew's just letting me know the lions might be on their way back down towards us. Kobe, thank you very much, Andrew. So we're going to leave this magnificent herd of elephants and try catch up with some lions. While we do that, we're with the biggest animal and Jamie's with the tallest.
Wow. Brent looks for lions. We are looking across straight into the Kruger National Park at a lovely bull giraffe. He's been playing a little bit camera shy actually. He stood and stared at us right out into the open, up until the point that you jumped on the back of our vehicle, at which point he turned his back upon us. I know that I've always known, of course, we are completely open to the boundaries of Kruger National Park. We are part of the Greater Kruger National Park, the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park, if I want to be technically correct. But I always get a little bit of a shiver. I have grown up travelling to the Kruger National Park throughout my life. And obviously since I've moved to this area, I've spent a great deal of time there. And yet I always get a little bit of a shiver of history, an awareness of history, whenever I'm around it. And to be fortunate enough to sit right here and watch the animals as they move between the Great Kruger and into the Sabi Sands is such a treat. In this case, a giraffe who's making short work of what looks like... thank you, Dave. Making life much easier. Thank you very much. What looks like a knobthorn tree. It's either a knobthorn or a... black monkey thorn, which looks like a knob thorn from where I'm sitting. So something with incredibly pointy and comfortable thorns, something that we would never even consider putting anywhere near our mouths. But our very handsome giraffe gentleman in the light of the setting sun is clearly enjoying it. The oxpecker has found a really comfortable spot. there at the, perched on the protrusions on the back of a male giraffe's head. We've got a really nice opportunity to have a look at those ossicones, the horns on the top of a giraffe's head. Very clearly a male. You can see the bald patches most distinctly from this angle, but also you can see how thick and powerful looking those bony ossicones are. However, if you look really carefully to where that oxpecker is perched, there you go. See how there's two protrusions between his ears? And then, if he would be so kind as to turn his head at some point, you'll also see the extension of the skull. Thank you very much, boy. That lump in front of the ossicones. So that together, actually, the sort of the combination of the ossicones and those protrusions around his skull is what makes a male giraffe, or gives the male giraffe, a formidable weapon when they tackle other males in the process that is known as necking, so swinging it round and hitting them with their heads. So it's not just the ossicones. If they miss with the impact for the ossicones, or if they're looking to increase the damage that they do, having those lumps at the back of the neck here, as well as the protrusion on sort of the essentially the forehead area of a male giraffe, will also add to the impact that that will have. I've just had an update from Shanae. Many of you will be familiar with Shanae. She works at Emporo. And she tells me that, actually, we've still got a nice view of him. Sorry, before I go rushing off, I've been looking at male leopard tracks along this Kruger National Park boundary. And she's just let me know that Shimamalana is very close to the Emporo Lodge. Just to the north of our Cheetah Plains Traverse area. Not far from us at all. We go where the birds have been alarm calling for the last few minutes. Quiet. Not as frantically, however, as they might for a leopard, so I'm not going to go rushing off just yet. This is very close to where I last saw Nkanyeni. While I head across and look for her, let's go over to Brent, who has found one of the more unusual mammals on Juma.
Look at this, some baboons. They are such funny creatures, and we are seeing more and more of them as we get deeper into the dry season. Now that could be food pressure that's causing them to travel greater and greater distances to try sustain themselves. So we just wanted to get a safety shot in the distance. You obviously you've got a kudu there as well. Mm-hmm. Oh look, dwarf mongoose attack here, slender mongoose. You got it, there's the slender mongoose. He just got attacked by a dwarf mongoose. So the dwarf mongoose, the little dwarf mongooses mobbed him. There was a whole bunch of them. So obviously a slender mongoose is a threat to their babies. And there's the victor. Look at him, looking very chuffed with himself, half the size, but he wasn't alone. There was a couple of them that mobbed that slender mongoose. So obviously they've got young ones, and they don't want that slender mongoose around anywhere near them. Vim's very happy. He said he wanted to see a slender mongoose earlier today. But we'll see if we can catch up with those baboons. And hopefully the lions are going to be heading this way. The Vuyatela. Water apart the Galago pad, so there's a very good chance that those lions are going to come down here, if not during drive, after drive. So keep an eye on the Juma Dam cam. And wouldn't it be incredible if those baboons spot the lions? I know a lot of you have heard my story about how baboons shout at lions. They go, lion! And the other baboon goes, where? And it goes, over there! So it'll be really funny if you actually get, if we actually get to witness them shouting at the lion. I would be very excited. But now while we try to catch up with the baboons, there's been some speculation to what this massive secret VM and I have been keeping is. And Gracie, who's 8 years old and one of our favorite regular viewers, as well as lots of other people, speculate, could it be babies. Fiam, is it babies? I'm not sure. I don't know. Is it babies? Is it a baby? It could be a baby. Baby dwarf fungus. Like that one that just was just there. Is it a baby baboon that was riding on its mom's back? I don't know if it's babies. I think we're going to keep you... Oh, there go the baboons in front of us. They just dashed across the road. Let's try and get a little bit closer slowly. I think we're going to keep you in suspense a little longer. Well, we really have had a full bag of different species today. Buffalo, elephant, kudu, impala, baboons, dwarf mongoose, slender mongoose. Hopefully these baboons have not... Here they are. Here's one. See it on the... There they are. Oh, and they are disappearing. Here you go. Bye-bye, Bobbejans. Not used to game drive vehicles, you can see, but hopefully as the dry season progresses, they become more and more used to us. I think they're coming from an area where they don't see a lot of cars. The big secret is actually, VM's got a new hat. No, it's not. We're just still playing with you. But VM does have a new hat as well. No, the other one, the blue one.
Oh, the blue one.
You do have a new hat. He's not wearing his new hat, though. So, last I heard from Andrew, is that the four Nkuhumas and one a Birmingham male were heading due west through some very thick bush. So they might possibly pop out on the boundary around Tamburti Dam, and that's where we're heading right now. Did you see that, Vim? There's some Franklin fighting. Look at that. Crested Franklins. Now, this is right at the end of their mating season. They still have some of them. I've seen a few babies around. Oh, off they went. There's two males there. Now, they've got an incredibly sharp spur on their feet that they use to attack each other, very much like a chicken when they're competing for dominance. They seem to be doing a lot of shouting. Oh, and they've disappeared. But now, from us on our way to look for lions, let's go to Jamie while she shows you an exquisite African sunset.
You've just in time to catch the last rays of the sun as it disappears. Just a moment to enjoy in silence for now. Africa treating us to another spectacular sunset. I can't say that I've ever experienced an awful one out here. All serenaded to the sound of the arrow-marked babbler. Noisy. Doing their dusk chorus as the sun starts to go down, making plenty of noise before they head across to bed. One interesting thing that birds do just before we carry on, very often what they'll do, woodhoopers do it and babblers do it as well, they call in one tree and then immediately move off to the next tree and go to sleep there. So kind of like a diversion tactic, as if to say we're going to... Sorry. mid-sentence stop there. It's just because I'm now listening to alarm calls from wildebeest, plus grey go-away birds are also calling. And I'm just trying to get a direction on it. But yes, birds will call and then from one tree and then go to sleep in another one just a little way away from that, in order so that if any predators have been attracted by the sounds of their calls, that they can then sort of, basically it's almost like flash coloration, just with the flash sounds. Sorry, okay, it was a bird of prey. It was a goshawk. It flew straight behind Dave's head, and that was the reason for the upset go-away birds. The wildebeest, I think, is just announcing his territory. It sounds like a male. There's no snort to the prelude to the om sound that he was making. I don't think we need to go rushing off to follow up on those alarm calls. And that goshawk's been pushed away by the go-away birds and the rollers towards Kruger. And that would explain the babblers as well. That's why they were chirruping away. Oh, we're at a part of Cheetah Plains known as Buffalo Dam or Buffalo Pan. Can't remember if it's called Pan or Dam. Definitely quite a lovely spot and apparently one of Nkanyeni's favourite places to be. It's been a while since I've had a chance to explore this particular part of Cheetah Plains, so I'm just really enjoying the opportunity and the silence and the peace of the evening. At the same time, of course, keeping an eye out for any sign of the wonderful animals, and in Kanyeni especially. I'm so excited to have a chance to see her and her two cubs. Notice that I haven't been driving around Cheetah Plains with a map any longer. That's because I've pretty much familiarized myself with all of the roads here. That being said, now that I think about it, if I had to find any sighting now, whilst I know exactly where I am and where I'm going to come out on this road, I have no idea what this road is called. Oopsie. Maybe I should make doubly sure that I keep a map with me. I didn't quite think of that. I'll end up having to describe where we are rather than to give the exact road name. This morning we started off our morning pretty much with a sighting around the Arethusa Dam with the clan from Elephant Plains and from Arethusa, the hyena clan in that area. Individuals we might have seen on and off throughout our drives, but the first time since I've started working here that I've had them all together as a group, as a clan. I've heard many stories about the great hyena clans of Elephant Plains, but I've yet to see them up until this morning. And apparently number close to 30 individuals, if not more. And the reason I'm mentioning this is because there's very little hyena activity on Cheetah Plains. I've just seen some tracks crossing through into Kruger. But beyond that, you know how we always drive around Juma and we're forever pulling over to the side and then going, oh no, it's a hyena track, it's not a leopard or a lion. That's something that doesn't occur all that much on Cheetah Plains. We hardly even see their tracks. I've seen no latrines, and I'm very curious as to what the reason behind that is. It might just be coincidence, but it is an interesting observation. There's clearly something that makes the Juma and the Arethusa Elephant Plains area more attractive to the hyenas. And you'd think that hyena, I mean, it might just be that there is a very large clan in Kruger and that this is the outskirts of their home range or their territory. And it might, of course, be pure coincidence. There's been lots of lion activity around here. So it's not as though they wouldn't have plenty to scavenge. Oh, how wonderful. Oh, this is going to be the perfect way to enjoy the last bit of life. The reason I'm saying that is there's a whole herd of elephants ahead of me, just beyond where you can see, on the open area around the dam. Let's go through and have a look at them before they start to wander back to Kruger. Yes, I mean, it's open to conjecture. You're welcome to put forward your reasons for why you think it is we don't see as many hyena. They've got to be around. Maybe this is just the outskirts of our clan's territory, the Juma clan's territory. James has said before that he thinks that they wander all the way to the east here. That's entirely possible. No, we've picked up a passenger in the form of a large branch. There we go. It's making a lot of noise. Oh, and there's a huge bull that we're going to see with the rest of the herd. He's actually upsetting the herd a little bit, pushing his luck with the rest of them and some of the younger females. Let's take a moment to stop at a distance because we can watch the interplay and the dynamics in this clearing with this camera. Here's the big bull, second from the left. He's pushed his way into prime drinking spot. And one young bull is splashing about off to his left. And you really get an idea of size difference and about a decade of growth will make. The bull on the left is young. He's young enough still to be with the herd. And the bull on the right is, oh, look at that. Elephants are such complex creatures. They don't always behave as you expect them to. And that was a submissive response from the male on the left. A friendly gesture. It hasn't been met with the greatest of enthusiasm, but that is what he was attempting to do. The rest of the herd making sure to give him plenty of space. I think he could well be the bull that we saw earlier when we first approached this dam at the start of the afternoon. You can see the differences in the level of confidence. A bull quite content to move off on his own and drink. The females protectively bunching together with the rest of the calves and the youngsters. It's all right. Dave just double checking the leveling on the camera. I think it took him by surprise there.
A little bit.
Just a little bit. Oh, big bull is having a shower. There's an incredible serenity to a sighting like this. And Dave, if we can look at the elephant on the far right. Look at that tusk. Isn't she awesome? Look at that. Just goes to show the genetic variation that comes through for each individual's tusks. I'm not sure if you managed to catch a good glimpse of her. She's got a really, really long, straight left tusk. And then a really short, pointy right one. And Chris Rogue has just said, oh, how awesome is this? I agree completely. And I actually really enjoy sightings like this where you can watch them from afar. You don't always have to do it. Obviously, it's beautiful being up close to them as well. But to watch them from afar, you get to watch the dynamics at play at the same time. There she is, with her strange pointy left tusk. She reminds me of an elephant I knew called Madame M, who had a very similar tusk arrangement. Alison, welcome to our sunset safari. I hope you are enjoying the sighting as much as we are. You were wondering if we're talking about an elephant bull, who is very visible in the middle of that herd, standing a good, I would say, 5 or 6 feet at the shoulder above the rest of them. You were wondering, what is a female elephant called, if a male is called a bull, and what is a baby called? A female is called a cow, and a juvenile elephant, like the one that we can see hanging about at the back there, every now and again, there we go. It's called a calf. So very much like a cow. A bull, a cow, and a calf. And the same applies to hippo, to rhino, buffalo, and most of the larger antelope species. That's the correct terminology for them. Little one. They've picked the toughest spot for you to go and have a drink. That's going to be really difficult with a short trunk. No trouble for the bull or for the larger females, but the little ones are going to have to scurry round to the other side. They're never going to be able to reach that far down. We're about, I would say, close to about 150 feet away. I can barely hear a thing. We've got several hundred tons of animal wandering about here. No, it's not, that's an exaggeration. We've got close to 50 tons of animal moving around. And not a sound is made, just the gentle splashing of the water. There we go, found a slightly easier spot to drink from. And that individual pushing away some of the yuckier water, the sandier, muddier, more murky water, to get to the fresh stuff at the back. Elephants, as I mentioned at the start of our sunset safari, actually quite fussy drinkers if they can be. I would love to be able to be an elephant for a day and actually communicate with them, understand and speak their language. Because the herd is split apart for now, and they've got the presence of an enormous bull. This cow that we're watching walking in front of us is probably one of the largest in this herd. So she will be one of the oldest individual members, with decades worth of accumulated wisdom. Oh, and the rest of them now starting to move off. Yeah, she's encouraging them all that it's time to go. Bull not quite finished with his drink. And the younger male trying to imitate him, standing right next to him to drink, but not quite having the length to comfortably do that. And it's managed, though. He's managed. Looks as though he's about to go tumbling head first into the dam. While the male finishes off his drinks, or his drink stop. The rest of the herd is disappearing off back towards the Kruger National Park. Very peaceful sighting. Okay. Bye-bye, elephants. Thank you for that. I really enjoyed it. We have a spectacular view on our side, and apparently Brent has also got another lovely view to show you. So let's head on to the back of Wendy.
So we're sitting on the northern boundary looking west. And you can see the Drakensberg Mountains in the distance. And this is the area where the lions are supposed to pop out, but not a bad area to just sit and take a quiet moment and look at our surrounds. We can hear some elephants off to the north of us. No sign of the lions just yet. I think we're going to just meander on down the boundary up to the crest we can see over there, and then we'll turn around and come back, and hopefully by then the lions might have crossed. Now, of course, lions being lions will quite often walk for 20 minutes, sleep for 20 minutes, walk for 20 minutes, sleep for 20 minutes. So they might be having a schnooze, but I am hoping they do cross. And I definitely think the closest water to here is the Juma Dam Cam, so hopefully if they don't make an appearance on the Sunset Safari, they shall on the Juma Dam Cam. So I think now, do you think it's time to let go of the secret head, VM? Let's see how evil VM's feeling. Well, James Richards got the closest to the surprise so far. So maybe James, Commander Bond Hendry, and Geraldine Kent will be collaborating on a Safari Live cheesecake cookbook. I can definitely say that's not the surprise, James, but a very good thing. Maybe we should prompt them to do such. And I think you're going to have to include old Kirsten McLennan Smith and Rebecca in the cheesecake making fraternity. So VM, have you decided yet? I'm going to leave it up to VM when we tell you. How's that?
I think we should do it at the end of the show.
Ah, okay. VM, I think we're gonna save it for the last few moments of the show. I think that's an excellent idea, VM. And I still haven't heard anything about the Nearly Impossible Tree Quiz. Did you guys forget? I think I've got you, and no one wants to send an answer. Well, Jen B says if we keep being mean, that you guys are going to be forced to start rumors that VM and I are running off into the sunset together. And Jen, well, that's exactly what we're doing. We're heading straight west to the sunset. So off we go, running towards the sunset, but just to have a view. Nothing nefarious about our running towards the sunset. We do it quite often on the Sunset Safari. We are really hoping that those lions just make sure they haven't decided to sneak out behind us. Like, that happened to me and Dave this morning. We were watching three lionesses. We only knew there were three lionesses. They were jogging, jogging, jogging. And as I turned around, there was a male and female behind me. I do love this time of the day, though. It is spectacular. Gilly. Well done, Gilly from York, who got the nearly impossible tree quiz half right. She says, is it a bush willow? It is, but which bush willow was the nearly impossible tree quiz today? I'll give you guys a little time to stew over that. Which bush willow was the nearly impossible tree quiz today? It was a very tough one because it had been munched on by a whole bunch of caterpillars. But it indeed was a bush willow. So half points. Keep checking over my shoulder. No sign of anything yet. Might as well, while we're up here, go have a quick squiz at Sydney's waterhole. See if there's anything happening about there. This is probably the highest point on Juma at the moment, right up here on this crest. Just listening to the Game Drive radio. There we go. Approaching Sydney's waterhole. Maybe there's something mysterious there. Getting a bit nippy. So this is near where Jamie saw that African wildcat. Wanderlust is wondering what sort of education do the guides have. Well, when it comes, there's a lot of very basic ranger training courses that'll give you a sort of very basic understanding of the bush and whatnot. But you'll find most of the really good guides do a lot of the learning by themselves through experience. And you will often find any one of us after drive perusing through, researching something we might not be sure of, and it's a constant learning experience, and I think that's the best way to describe it. You never stop learning, never stop asking questions.
And while Brent checks out Sydney's Dam, we're heading out to explore the mysteries of Cheetah Plains in the evenings. The signal did just drop while he was there. That's why he disappeared off your screens once again. Wendy appears to be suffering significantly from gremlins, this today in particular. And our tech team are working furiously to right the situation. I'm not sure if Brent's given you his surprise or not now. I know the answer. Brent's thinking about keeping it a secret, I hear. Well, far be it for me to tell secrets that are not mine to tell. I know what it is. We're going to keep you all guessing, apparently. I think that I would be in very big trouble if I gave anything away, so I better keep my mouth tightly sealed. Wanderlack, Brent was in the middle of answering your question before he disappeared off your screens, but you wanted to know about what sort of education a guide needs in order to do this kind of job. And it's an interesting question. It's one that we get asked relatively frequently. And you'll find that for all of us, we all have exceptionally different backgrounds. Brent, of course, having pretty much grown up in this lifestyle. He's had the most phenomenal background in terms of being in the African bush and traveling throughout different parts of Africa. Having a degree in some kind of natural sciences is nice, but not a requirement in any way. I myself do not have one. Obviously, I did science and biology and so on for school, but I went on to do a law degree. As you can see, my legal career has been sterling so far. That being said, there are lots of training courses you can do. There is no lodge or anything in the world that will send you out inexperienced into the bush. So it usually takes a good few months before you start taking your first game drive. Sorry, we have to stop for this. It's just too beautiful. Just making sure my light's off. Is there a more beautiful silhouette? Or a more striking silhouette than that of a giraffe, highlighted against the sky? Hello, boy. A noble profile. In Bushman mythology, they don't have the constellations that Western culture have followed, that comes from Greek myths and Roman myths, stories of Orion and Scorpius. Instead, their constellations are of African animals. And one of them, a sort of a series of stars that lines the horizon to the south. I'm not sure what constellation that is in Western terms, but to the bushmen of the African areas, that's a journey of giraffe walking across the sky. And when we have scenes like this, even as he does make life difficult by disappearing behind the trees, you can understand just why something like that captured their imagination to the point that they named the constellations and the stars that they were seeing after it. Really is a stunning scene. Right, we just had to stop for that quickly, but we were trying to get my hair under control. It's a bit tricky. But we shall try. We were talking about education and where we get our knowledge from. Now, we've all acquired it in different ways and different means, but you'll find that all of us, from myself, Brent, James, and Steph and Sam, all united by a passion in terms of what we are doing. For us, it's not like learning, it's not like doing homework. We're so fortunate that because everything that we see is magical and interesting, whether it's the smallest insect to the largest animal, the time that we spend out here, we get to just learn more and more when we are out here. And some of us have different areas of expertise, some of us have different subjects that we enjoy learning about more than others, but we're all united in the passion and the enjoyment that we get out of here. And it's, for us, it's not a job. For us, it is very much our lives. I don't think any of us could really imagine doing anything different or living a life that is any different. And we're so fortunate in that for all of us, we have an opportunity to share it with other people, and in our case, to share it with the most enormous audience across the globe. And that ultimately is what we aim to do. We tell the different stories of the animals, but most of all, it's about the joy and the wonder and the little intricacies that the nature has to offer here. And there's no better place in the world, in my opinion, to work. And I'm sure the same can be said for the cameramen, just in their particular fields. There's a reason why I think we have some of the best cameramen on the planet. First of all, it's wildlife, it's filming animals. And it's filming animals live without editing. And a lot of them have feathers and wings and tend to fly away. And the others run very fast. There's all kinds of intricacies to it, and they have to sit on the back of a bumping moving vehicle all the time and somehow manage not to make the audience motion sick. And there's a whole lot of, you can imagine, there's a whole, an enormous amount that goes on behind the scenes, and you interact a great deal with us as the guides and then the cameraman showing you the pictures, but there's a team behind the scenes, a technical team, the directors and the producers that work exceptionally hard to bring the show onto your screens day after day, twice a day, every day. Most important thing in terms of is time spent out here and learning a little bit about, a little bit every day. And when you think about it, even if we only are out driving three times in the morning and three times in the afternoon, usually a normal game drive time is much, much longer. But just think about how many hours. We don't take weekends, we don't take public holidays, we do take leave every now and again. But just think about how many hours that equates to in terms of our day-to-day lives. All right, Brent has got signal once again. Let's find out if he did manage to find anything at Sydney's Dam.
So there we go, Vim showing you we're not the only ones searching for those lions. And we've just been sitting quietly once we got signal again and listening, but doesn't look like they've popped out yet. So let's see what else is out here. Oh, where's my spotlight? There it is. So I've got a sneaky suspicion we might not get any luck with them this evening. I think they've gone flat again. But another exciting news here from the African bush. Tracks of a male leopard head into this general area as well. I'm pretty sure it's the same one we were looking for this morning. And I'm pretty sure it's Tingana just from where he's walked. So, spotlight out, leopard eyes on. Of course, I've got to find lots of other little interesting nocturnal creatures. I'm very jealous of my dad at the moment. In the last week, he has seen four aardvark and had a pangolin crawl under his game drive vehicle. And he's not that far from us. And so I'm hoping we can try emulate with one of those spectacular creatures. I don't think either have ever been seen on Safari Live. So fingers crossed. I might do a little victory dance if we find either. I have seen aardvark and pangolin in the Sabi Sands before, but never here in the north. I found their tracks, but never them. Where are you? So pangolin, probably the best place to look on Juma is either around Twin Dams itself or on Inyala Road north and south. There's a very particular reason for this. In the Sabi Sands, 98% of a pangolin's diet is one species of ant called a pugnacious ant. They are vile little ants. And when you walk near them, they attack your feet. Hence the name pugnacious. But to a pangolin, they are a delicacy. And of course, Liam and I are still keeping a very big secret that we might let you have at the end of the safari, we'll see. Vian thinks we should do it in the last little bit of the safari. I don't know, do you think we could pull it off, work it till tomorrow morning, Vian?
Nah, I don't want to.
Nah. Vian says it would be unfair to keep you in suspense till the sunrise safari. And Aaron thinks maybe the Nkuhuma ladies are going to take over from the final control ladies. Well, that would be an interesting show to the Nkuhuma ladies directing the drive. Chase the buffalo towards their final control. Chase the buffalo to final control. As I don't think much work would be done. We've got some very interesting answers coming in at the moment. Sarah Wood says that Steph has found a wormhole or time warp and is going to come out of it on Bushwalk with all the answers to the questions of the universe. Now, Steph would quite like that, but who knows, maybe he has. I severely doubt it, though. Oh, push baby. And our little guy, oh, he's probably going to leap. Is he going to leap across in front of us? Look at him. Hello, little mister. You got him, Vim? There he is. Hello, little bush. Oh, big jump, big jump, big jump, big jump, gone. Oh, he was very quick. Anyway, that was a lovely little view, even if it was very short. He's done it. Big jump, big jump, big jump, gone. Oh, no, he is very far gone by now. Such fascinating little primates. The smallest primate we get here on in the Sabi Sands, the South African Galego or lesser bush baby. What is that through there? That warrants a bit more investigation. No, it doesn't. I apologize. It was a baby Nyala, or sub-adult Nyala, so about the right size for a leopard, but it was schnot, and then suddenly saw the others around it. So back to the nearly impossible tree quiz. Someone said russet bush willow. That is incorrect. It is the most, I'll give you another hint, make it not such an impossible tree quiz. It's the most common bush willow in the Sabi Sands. Let's see who's the quickest on the keyboard to get that one in. It's the most common bush willow in the Sabi Sands. Send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. The elephants have made this road very, very bumpy. Like a rag doll here. And we're off. Where are the cats today? Well, we know where they were. They were in Buffalo's Hook. Why have they not come back for a sunset visit? Well, I'll sunrise safari. Or make a cameo appearance towards the end of this safari. Now, this is always something very cool to do. There's a big herd of elephants up ahead. Oh. and we don't put our big spotlights on them. And it's sometimes amazing if you just sit. And with our side lights, we'll just pick up a few of them just on the edge of the light. You can just see the gleaming tusk there. But you should be able to hear them as they move towards us. Elephant fart, we just heard that. And you can actually even hear the one next to us digging. So after dark, a lot of sounds are much louder. There's not so much noise from birds and wind. It's very still at the moment. Are there more elephants in the Juma pad? There are, I think. Are there buffalo? I can't really see.
Elephants.
Elephants. And I think this herd we're sitting with at the moment is also on its way there. Just gonna move forward a little bit. Try get right in the middle of these elephants. And I'm just going to stop and listen. I can hear two young boys fighting again. God. Just got to be really careful and considerate when you drive through an elephant herd at night. Slow, steady, still. There we go, you can see them popping up here. And they are heading straight towards. And you can see that it's a bit grainy. VM's pumped the ISO on the camera. So it's not nearly that light in our, with our natural eyes. He's using that camera lens to manipulate what little light is around. You can actually even see quite clearly the suckle marks on her teeth there, how moist it is. So she's obviously been suckling recently. Oh, what's she got in her mouth? Looks like a big root. That must have been what she was digging up next to the road. Oh, I would really love to know what tuber that is, but I think it's going to be a little bit difficult to identify. Maybe she'll leave it there and I can come have a look in the morning. Oh, Fem, we're being attacked on the left. You thought we didn't see you sneaking up on us. And is that the baby who was sucking? It could very well be. Oh, you can just hear elephants everywhere. You can see all the
little nocturnal insects buzzing around. These are little midges. In South Africa, our colloquialism for them is muggies. Okay, I'm going to try and sneak a bit further forward through the herd now. So you really don't want to upset them, so very, very slow movements. And of course, you can't see everything that's going around at night, so it makes it just that little bit more, or you just have to be that little bit more careful. Looks like we're through. Now all these eddies around the waterhole might put off the lion and leopard from coming for a drink just yet. They might wait till a little bit later when all the elephants move off. Some elephants kicking up dust. Oof. Upset. Down in the bottom of what was once the dam. They're quite far away from us. And then I'm going to move my spotlight to check on the other side here while you look at the silhouettes. Isn't that just quite gorgeous? I can see a bigger moth fluttered through the screen there. That beautiful night sky starting as the light fades in the west. I see the eddies down there. James Richard said, seen elephants pick up tubers like that before, but they rarely eat them. Well, I think it just depends, and I think with this dry season in there, a lack of food around, they might start eating stuff we're not so used to seeing them eating. And I have seen them eat lots of tubers before in northern Botswana. But of course that's a far drier climate than here. I'm going to try and see if we can get to the little pan there. See if that's a better view. Use that ambient light from the dam cam's spotlight. So, hi Janet, welcome on Safari Live. Janet's wondering if an elephant calf baby walked up to our vehicle and was very curious, would we be able to interact and play with it? I mean, we get close enough that sometimes you could possibly touch them. They're a very bad idea. You'd be teaching that elephant very bad habits later in life. And once that, you must remember, a baby elephant, even if it's a female, turns into 4, 3.5 tons later. And what might be a little bit of fun when it's small turns into a potentially incredibly dangerous situation when it's old. So we don't. If the elephant comes too close, we often...
Oh no, I think it's disappeared, unfortunately. It was a white-tailed mongoose that has just gone dashing off into Torchwood. Just a little bit. Oh, there it goes. Ah! No, come back. I just saw it run across that open patch there. Oh well. It was a nice attempt. Unfortunately, it disappeared before we could put it on camera for you. Just making sure it's not hiding behind that bush. I don't think so though. No, we'd catch the eye shine reflected back at us. Nope. Oh well, next time. We'll get it for you next time. Oh well, since we have found ourselves so close to the end of the sunset safari, I'm going to bid you all a very fond farewell. Thank you to Dave for all of his fantastic camera work, as always, as well as his company on the back of the vehicle, as well as to Rebecca and to Lou in final control. And again, most importantly, to all of you watching across the world, I hope you had a wonderful sunset safari. And we will catch you once again on the full rotation of the Earth when the sun's coming right back up again on the sunrise safari. Bye-bye and have a lovely day.
So we're sitting at the Juma Dam Cam and these ellies are just pouring in. It is just spectacular. Now, I'm going to have to give away some of the answers. The nearly impossible tree quiz was the red bush willow, the most common combretum species in the subcontinent. Oh, look at this, just appearing. Paul got it right. Look at this, it's just elephants appearing out of the darkness all around us. Gracie, who's 8 years old, says, Brent, please can we know the surprise? I'm little and I've got ants in my pants waiting to know. Well, Gracie, and to everyone out there, the really, really good news as the first Inkahuma cubs have been born. They were found in Torchwood on this sunset safari by Ephraim near First Rock. So there's the big news. And it is very exciting to have some lion cubs. So one lioness has given birth. That one we saw this morning, I think, will give birth in about another 3 to 4 weeks. So we should have lots of cubs around. The Styx cubs have got 8. Can the Inkahumas get more? But let's just look at these ellies around us at the moment. Isn't this spectacular? Oh, argument down there. Hello, big lady. Off she goes. There, that was her who made that noise. So many different communications an elephant can make. This is just really special. Really, really beautiful. So for the last little bit of drive, let's just watch these elephants and don't forget to join us bright and early for the sunrise safari tomorrow. But from all of us here, good night and enjoy the elephants from our camera. And soon as it's done, from the Juma Dam cam. Oh, another one appearing out of the darkness.
We're not going to sit in your way. We're going to move so you can see the elephants without us. See you all tomorrow on the sunrise.